Angel, you're reading me!
Well, I was living in Gloucester in 1991 on a house that sort of overlooked the harbor, and I was home writing one day and looked out the window and the harbor just looked crazy. It was a really strange sound going through the phone lines. The wind was really picking up, and I saw these enormous waves coming in, 30-foot waves breaking off the back shore and destroying these houses.
I rode around the back shore with a friend of mine, and we looked out, and I just said, man, I am glad that we are home. And he says, yeah. Well, don't forget, the boys are still out there. And I go, oh, yeah, that's right. Those guys are out there. I said, that must be ungodly.
There's basically three storm fronts all colliding and all of them hitting at the same time, creating the worst storm in recorded history. And Sebastian Younger wrote a book about it.
What made it a sort of a perfect storm is that instead of going out to sea the way most storms do, this one went out into the North Atlantic and stopped and turned around and came back. It's called a retrograde, and it doesn't happen very often. It blew in the same place for 4 days. So the waves just got bigger and bigger, and by the end of the storm, they were over 100 feet.
They're monster seas, some of the biggest seas I've ever seen. And you knew it. There's pictures where there's actually green water breaking the bow. When you see green water, you know you're in for some trouble.
What was great about the book was that we learned about fishing, and we learned about a lifestyle that we didn't understand, and along the way we grew to like these characters.
That's an important moment now, that we push in, and she says, home safe. And she says, home safe. And maybe you turn, let me see, I want to see the Andrea Gale there in the background.
Hello, Bobby. Oh. Home safe.
I find it a fascinating thing out there at sea. There's something about it, something mysterious out there, what probably nobody can really describe what it is, but it has no limitations.
Let's go fishing.
Yeah! Yeah!
You go out there and your thoughts and dreams can go forever instead of banging right into a mountain.
Billy Tyne is the captain of the Andrea Gale. Well, he was a good fisherman.
For God's sake, don't go.
Bobby's a guy who loved to fish, you know, loved the idea of being out there, but also has, you know, this conflict because he's very much in love with somebody on land.
It's a very unique situation, that kind of waiting. And there's a huge legacy, legend, lore about that here locally in Gloucester and for all of the families. It's very stressful to a relationship.
I got a woman I can't stand to be more than 2 feet away from. And again, I love to fish.
This is the story of the worst storm disaster since the last century. I had the feeling, oh my God, how can you ever do that? You cannot go out there and shoot in this kind of weather. And that was the main thing, to make it really realistic. How do you do that? Big problem. On the other hand, we are all kind of adventurous. We all want to find out, is there a new barrier you want to go over and cross, you know, something what's never been done before?
As soon as I got here, I felt like, man, I wish we were shooting the whole movie here. I don't know, the place feels haunted or something. I guess it's because, you know, they've been fishing here for hundreds of years.
It was like a novel come to life, which was really astonishing.
Without exception, everyone in the cast has a kind of humility towards the experience of these people.
Rolling cameras. Background action!
Go, go!
Everybody that knew anybody or that had gone to school with anybody on that boat pretty much showed up to see what we were doing with it and if we were doing a good job.
It's probably the biggest thing that ever came to this town.
Roll it!
We were embraced with open arms.
We're also hiring many local people, and we run into them in restaurants and in bars, everybody has a story, everybody knows this story, and most of these guys have shipped out or been around the Andrea Gill and the docks all their lives. They're feeding us constant ideas. It keeps it authentic.
Boat stuff. Now what we're doing is actually landing at the docks with the Andrea Gill and the Hannah Bowden. I know you've all done a lot of different things. Anybody have that real experience?
Yeah, yeah, very much so.
Yeah, you know, you come in 5 feet, 4 feet, 3 feet, gotta go a little that way.
Is that what they do?
Yeah.
All right, that's what you do.
Professional deckhand.
These are real people. I want to be as truthful as I possibly can. I went to the Crow's Nest a couple of weeks before the production had come to town, and I met Bobby's brothers and sisters and his mom.
He just came down to the Crow's Nest one morning to meet us. And my mom was there, and my nephews, and my brothers. And we just kind of all hit it off.
Mark's a sweetheart, you know. I don't think they could have got a better guy to play the part.
Last night he was in and he even helped us out at the door. He was checking IDs for us. They come in and they say, "Where's Mark Wahlberg?" Like, he just checked your ID at the door.
A lot of guys I hung out with were friends of Billy Tynes, and they said, "Let me tell you some things about Billy." And they were great sort of insight in, not as much about the man as about the character of the men who do that.
Hey, you're a happy man out there, aren't you, Scott?
I'm doing what I was made to do. I got a feeling I'm going to do it even better this time.
He was a focused captain. He was a very intense, hardworking man, as were the members of his crew, or they wouldn't have had the Andrea Gill to run in the first place.
Fog's just lifting. Throw off your bow line, throw off your stern. Blow your air horn and throw a wave to the lighthouse keeper's kid on Thatcher Island. Guys are busy, you're in charge. You know what? You're a sword boat captain. Can't be good unless you love it.
Nice to meet you. I've been like waiting for an hour. So when's she coming out of there?
Linda Greenlaw is the only female sword boat captain. And on a sword boat, there are only 6 crew members, including the captain. And you go out for a month at a time.
You'd be gone 30 days, 35, 40 days, whatever. You're home for a couple days and you're gone again, so there really isn't any life.
It's like a love-hate relationship. You can't get away, it calls you back. You get off the boat, you say, "I'm never gonna go fishing on this boat again. Oh, that trip was terrible." You wind up down on the dock a day later. You gotta come back.
It's funny because here they are, the local people, you know, having George sightings. So they're starstruck, but we're really starstruck with them because it's their real life and they're the real heroes and heroines and the unsung song in a way.
It was late at night, like 12 o'clock, end of the day. We were hanging out, drinking beer, playing pool. A few fishermen were still hanging around there. One guy figured out that I'm the director of Perfect Storm, the movie, and he wobbled over to me and took my hat and said, "Make it real."
Just testing a couple of the different aspects of the swordfish that we're going to do for the film. Here, this is a guy who's just got caught. He's going to be thrashing like crazy as they're working him to the boat. And then after that, we'll unhook them and we'll actually gaff them, which is how they land them onto the deck. This is simulating the edge of the boat right here.
You know, you're basically fighting a 600-pound fish with 3 or 4 guys, and it's not an easy thing to do.
And we are exhausted. So you're filming this, it looks like movie magic, it's real magic. We are tired, it's like, man, I can't believe this.
The basic reality of going to sea for a month is the same as it was, you know, 100 years ago. You're way beyond help from anyone else. You're on your own.
Stand by, people. Coming again.
It's life and death.
what's at risk here is people living or dying, people going down. And I think that that pretty much runs throughout the core of the film.
Keep it steady.
The Coast Guard and the parajumpers, you know, the level of risk that they're always at in making decisions to rescue somebody, they're also making decisions about their own life.
They had to survive out in this water for 5-6 hours.
They're coming for us! At least one chance to grab a hold of that net!
The guys that do this for real, the real pararescue jumpers, the real pilots, we were fortunate enough to meet a lot of them. They've helped us out a lot. They've told us stories, they've, you know, briefed us, they've told us, you know, we get to go to real pilots and real PJs and ask, what would you be thinking right now? What would you be doing if, you know, you were going out? Would you be excited? When do you get scared?
Rolling cameras, action! Go!
One of us has built the biggest inside a stage tank that exists in the world now. They built it for Perfect Storm. It's huge. We had the entire 72-foot Andrei Gale in there. What's already a pretty scary idea, you know, to come on and say, could you build a tank for me? It's not an easy phone call. If we get the most elaborate big gimbal that could carry an entire boat, then we have a key in our hand to make all these big storm sequences work.
And they put a boat on top of a gimbal with 360 degrees of blue screen.
The first time I walked on the stage and I kind of just looked and it was just so big.
They're reinventing the wheel with the special effects on this movie.
Yeah, let's put it this way. We're in a soundstage, soundstage 16 of Warner Brothers, and I got my wristbands, I got my Dramamine. I have to.
Make sure now with everything, with the, that we get an extreme kind of angle as much as we can. Ready? And I'm prepared to shoot this.
We got all these cameras, every shot is 4 or 5 cameras. And we get back on the boat, and the first day back, you feel just like you felt when you were in Gloucester, out to sea.
First thing that happens is two wave makers start making the waves in the tank. Pretty big chop gets going in that tank. And then the boat starts rocking on the gimbal, dipping and rolling. Once that's going pretty good, the rain starts.
Go ahead, we'll raise the hull to starting position, please. And crane ship motion.
41, take one.
Rolling cameras, and action!
The cameras are swinging around as the boat is going in different directions, and the waves are going, and the dump tank's crashing. And the cannons are shooting, and it was a symphony. And Wolfgang was the conductor.
Such a rough, tough way of making a movie. Like, I like to work with actors very closely, and here, of course, you were in that weird situation that we were sitting on, like in a control room, and you remember, with all these monitors there and all these camera operators, and they had these long crane cameras. And if I really wanted to talk to an actor, not like just yelling action or so. Very often you just want to look at their eyes and really talk to them. I had to get to the tank with a boat, climb on board to talk to these actors. You know?
When the dump tank comes down, you can go down like this. It's all a little chaotic because we don't know exactly what happens. That's an underwater camera, right?
Yeah.
Because you get a lot of water. The crew, they don't want any more. They want to go home. And I want to feel that here.
I told Wolfgang, you know, before I had seen what was going to happen, that I would do anything he wanted me to do and not to worry, you know, I can handle anything. And Of course, I put my foot in my mouth.
Runway!
We're standing on the deck there. There's a reason I'm wearing this wetsuit, because we get wet.
Crazy.
There were a lot of times I would rather quit and never work again, and I'm going home, see you later. Like I told you earlier, there were a couple of times where I started crying in the middle of a take, and Wolfgang was like, wow, that is so great. And I was like, yeah, it wasn't an accident.
You had these cable bolts and a harness, and if you weren't wearing them, you know, you got knocked off. We actually did it to your camera guy a couple of times. We told him to stand over there. It was fun.
It feels so good, doesn't it?
But Mark and I did a scene where we're in the wheelhouse, and it's a real, you know, dramatic scene. The two of us are yelling at each other.
Take the wheel! Get the car! Take the goddamn wheel! That's an order!
The real trooper, Mark was. He was so sick that every other sentence, he would say a line, and then he would go, wah!
I was just hoping that he would get all of his lines out before I threw up on him.
I found real excited partners in ILM, you know, the George Lucas company in San Francisco, who are the best, I think, in the business when it comes to visual effects.
I think the harshness, brutality of the sea really is the emotion we were meant to convey and was re-emphasized by Wolfgang.
The big problem digitally is now to combine the real water of the foreground with their digitally created water for the entire sea state in the background, the connection with it.
It's great to take a real story and sort of interpret it that way. I think it's a great way of storytelling, and I think it really, you know, the reality of it kind of drew a lot of us to that story. So you're focusing on the foreground, the people on the boat, but then suddenly a lightning strike in the distance just shows you the whole ocean out there. I think that's very important. Like right here is a good example. So we show a lightning hit back there on that wave. Or here, you know, you see a little bit of a wave over here that has been added. And then on this other side here as well, you know, we show just doing some lightning frames, sort of like showing the monster in the background behind us.
Where does our water stop and theirs start? And that it looks like seamless, and that you don't feel any difference. ILM found a way to make that totally work. It is unbelievable. So you will never ever see it in perfect storm. What's the real foreground water? What's their water? And because of that, an audience is in for a real event.